A warm welcome to one and all attending the MedFin lecture held at MCL. We hope to soon have offline lectures where we can have done amongst us here in person. We are honored to have amongst us Professor Dan Frenkel from University of Cambridge, who has graciously accepted our invitation. I'd like to welcome our director, Dr. Ashish Lele, my colleague from MCL and other institutions, and the students. I will now request our director, Dr. Ashish Lele, to say a few words about Professor MedFin.
Thank you, Sarika, so much. Just like to start this talk by introducing to you, especially Dan, something about Professor James William MedFin, in whose honor this lecture has been organized. So Professor James William MedFin was the first director of NCL from 1949 to 1952. And when he accepted to the invitation of our Prime Minister at that time, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, to become the director of NCL, he was at that time an emeritus professor at Stanford University. So Professor MedFin was born in 1882 and he obtained his undergraduate degree in chemistry from the University of Toronto in 1903 and a PhD in chemistry from the University of Heidelberg in 1906. After that, he became the professor of physical chemistry at the University of Bristol, where he spent quite a bit of time till 1927, at which point of time he moved to Stanford University to become actually the first tenure rank professor in chemistry department at Stanford. So he himself, of course, was a highly distinguished scientist, excelled in the field of surface and colloid chemistry. And he actually introduced many fundamental concepts of thermodynamics in this area and made some seminal contributions to colloidal electrolytes, adsorption of gases on solid surfaces, and also measurement of properties of soaps and detergent solutions. And what I found very interesting when I read about him was that he introduced the word sorption in the literature of adsorption. And he also posited the existence of micelles to describe the dissolution of insoluble particles or molecules in water. So very, very interesting contributions there. He published about 450 papers. He became the Fellow of Royal Society and also won the Humphrey David Medal of the Royal Society. So upon arriving in Pune as the director of National Chemical Laboratory, he was actually instrumental in building the main building, which if you see the photograph of NCL, this is the main building that you will see. And he was able to build that in a period of only 3 years, which today, you know, after 75 years, it has become very difficult to build something like this in just a period of 3 years. I wouldn't know how to do that. But somehow at that time he managed. It probably was blessed with much less bureaucracy at that time. And when he came in, he actually coined the motto of NCL, the mission statement of NCL. And he proposed it to the Prime Minister, who was present at the inaugural ceremony of NCL in January 1950. And that motto of NCL is actually enshrined in the main foyer of the building as you enter the building. And the Prime Minister in his inaugural speech actually mentioned it. So Professor MedFin created at that time when he took over NCL, the six scientific divisions in NCL. And for my colleagues in NCL, you know, he also created what was called the Survey and Information Division in order to assist the director in scientific management of the lab. He was not really a great science manager. He was a first-rate scientist and had a very common sense approach to management and a very down-to-earth leadership. In fact, he was quite famous for what were called the Monday morning meetings, in which he would meet all the scientists at that time and discuss all the projects that were running at that time. And he, in fact, also involved all the support functions, the engineering, the administration, finance, and all of that. And all the problem solving, scientific and non-scientific, was done in those Monday morning meetings. So very sort of down to earth and you know, good manager, I would say. He did bring industry to NCL at that point of time, and he brought in the focus on basic chemicals. At that time, India had just turned independent country, so the whole chemical industry had to be set up in the country. So he actually brought a lot of focus on that. He was very much responsible for creating the culture of research and scientific discourse in NCL. And he did many interesting things. We have a book on NCL's history written by one of our former directors. And there are some very interesting and humorous anecdotes on how McBain did many things at NCL. So those who have not read the book, I would encourage you to read it. So today's organizational structure for NCL is a little more sophisticated, but all the foundations of that were actually laid down by Professor McBain, and they continue till this date. So it is in his honor that NCL started this particular J.W. McBain Memorial Lecture Series in Chemical Sciences in 1995. And today, Dan, you are delivering the 16th lecture in this series. And so with that bit of information about Professor McBain, I will now hand it over to Dr. Sarika Bhattacharya to introduce today's distinguished speaker. Over to you, Sarika.
Thank you, Ashish. Thank you for letting us know about so many things about Mr. McBain. I think we need to read about it also. Now, let me introduce today's speaker. Professor Dan Frenkel received his PhD in physical chemistry from the University of Amsterdam in 1977. As far as I am aware, he did it in experimental physical chemistry. It's not mentioned in the short bio sketch that he has sent me, but I think, Dan, you can correct me if I'm wrong. Now, subsequently, he was a postdoc at UCLA and worked at Shell Research in Amsterdam, at the University of Utrecht and Amsterdam, and at the FOM Institute, ANOLS. This institute is an academic institute for fundamental physics with high social relevance, societal relevance, you know, so which can, like, you can connect it to NCL's motto, I think. In 2007, he was appointed 1968 chair of chemistry in Cambridge, where he was head of the department from 2011 to 2016. He is a member of six academies of science, and he has an honorary fellow. He is an honorary fellow of Trinity College, Cambridge. Then he has numerous awards, and a few of them are the Boltzmann Award, the Rahman Prize Award, and the Alder Seacamp Award. The Boltzmann Award, I think the last Nobel laureate, Parisi, also received at one point, honors outstanding achievement in statistical physics. Dan received the award for his seminal contributions to the statistical mechanics, understanding of kinetics, self-assembly, and phase behavior of complex macromolecules, colloidal, and biomolecular systems through highly innovative simulation methodologies. And also the Anisul Rahman Award and the Alder Seacamp prizes are also for computational physics. So about Dan, Professor Giovanni Ciccotti had written, he's from University of Roma at La Sapienza, that throughout his career, Dan Frenkel has been pushing the concepts and tools of statistical mechanics to their limit in an effort to develop new methodologies and algorithms enabling the study of complex systems and phenomena through large-scale molecular simulation. He is arguably the most creative and diverse simulator of soft matter and self-assembly of complex macromolecular systems of his generation. So you can understand that he is an expert in simulation, and this book of his, which is basically Understanding Molecular Dynamics Simulation, is a Bible for any group who wants to do simulation. With that, with no further ado, I will now request Dan to enlighten us about the entropy and the information or disinformation that he wants to talk about.
Well, thank you very much. Yes, thank you very much, Sarika, for this introduction. Also, I should like to thank the director for the very nice introduction and the overview of the contributions of Professor McBain. I realized that Professor McBain was in Bristol at the same time as Leonard Jones, because Leonard Jones, my predecessor, was in Bristol before he came to Cambridge, and so they must have been colleagues at the time. I hadn't realized that. Anyway, I'm very happy to give this talk today, although of course I would have been even happier if I could have been in Pune, so I hope that at some point I'll be able to make up for this. I want to give a talk that is a mixture of things that are well known and things that maybe are a bit less well known about entropy. And I know that entropy is a concept that people have been discussing for a long time. And so you see pictures of three famous people. You probably know at least two of them, but you'll meet all three of them during my talk. And without further ado, I just will start discussing the science, except that I have to do one thing, and that is to tell a bit about the people who actually contribute to parts of the research I discussed. And so there's a number of people who are students or postdocs in Cambridge: Daniel Zenyu, Fabien Paluson, Julian Schrenk, Stefano Martignani. I also collaborated with Ning Zhu, who is now professor in China. You probably know Srikant Sastri in Bangalore, who was involved in part of the project together with his student Arun Gopati and my postdoc Minji Zhu. But we'll come to that. But before that, I do that, I want to say one thing about the pandemic. And of course, during the pandemic, we couldn't travel, we couldn't see things as people. And we have also lost people in a period where we basically couldn't travel and sort of pay our honors to them. And so there's one person in particular in India whom I will miss very, very much, and that is Surajit Sengupta, whom many of you may know. He was a wonderful scientist. I met him in the 1990s when he was working with Peter Nilaba in Germany. I have kept in contact ever since. And he, of course, as you realize, he died when he was still quite young. It was all a terrible shock to us, and I just remember him fondly. And so I don't want to start my talk without having mentioned him. Okay. So now we move to entropy, and as I guess many of you have been taught about thermodynamics and entropy, you may think that this is a topic that's about which too much has been said already. And in a sense, I could even say too much has been said about it, because not everything that people say about it is particularly relevant. But there are still developments at the moment in how we deal with entropy that I think make it worthwhile discussing this topic. And in order to understand what we do now, I think it's good to go back to the origins. And so the origins of thermodynamics, in particular, entropy it was introduced into thermodynamics. You have to realize that thermodynamics, and I would say it's a bit in the spirit of NPL, it was something that had to do with direct practical problems that people faced in the early 19th century. Namely, what was the maximum amount of work you could get out of a steam engine? And so the person who formulated all the questions in this field is Sadi Carnot, who is one of my heroes, because he wrote a book about the efficiency of steam engines that basically formulated all the questions that later resulted in thermodynamics. He didn't himself invent thermodynamics as we know it, and the reason why he didn't is because at that time there was the what we call the caloric theory of heat, which assumed that heat was a substance and that therefore heat was conserved. And Sadi Carnot in his work had to assume that, because that was what all the experimentalists were saying. But it's clear from what he writes that he didn't really believe it, because he said when a body returns to its original state, so after a cycle, it is found to contain the same quantity of heat that it's contained that it contained at first. So that's typically what you say if you want to say something is conserved. If you bring the system back to the original state, you have the same amount. But then actually Carnot goes on to say This fact has never been questioned, but many experimental facts appear almost inexplicable in this present state of theory. So it's clear that Carnot actually doesn't believe it, but he had to, and so he formulated the right questions, but he didn't quite formulate he didn't get to formulating the solution. We had to wait for people like Clausius to do that. And so Clausius, at the time of Clausius, we basically got the laws of thermodynamics. The first law had already in basically been constructed, which is the fact that energy is conserved. The second law, we all know, that's the one that deals with entropy, but actually in its simplest formulation, it is something that relates to everyday experience. And I will, therefore, to show how simple it is, I'll take the version of the second law that was presented in a song by a famous British duo in the early 1960s, Flanders and Swann. And they express the second law of thermodynamics as follows. They say, heat won't pass from a cooler to a hotter. You can try if you like, but you're far better notter. So basically, it just says that if you bring two bodies in contact, that heat will always flow from the hot body to the cold body. And then maybe I should say, and it has to be always means except for fluctuations, but that's basically the essence of the law. And so it's a very simple law, but that is not what we use when we actually work with thermodynamics. I mean, if thermodynamics was only that, then it would be extremely easy. The thing that happened next, and that's what Clausius did, is to use this very simple law that heat will not spontaneously flow from cold to hot, and use that to introduce a quantity that he called entropy. And so basically, I will not go through the steps that Clausius made that actually are not very complicated, but if you've seen them in thermodynamics, you may or may not remember, and if you haven't seen them, then what I would say in a minute would not help you. But basically, what Clausius said, he introduced in his article of 1857 the idea that there was a quantity that he called entropy, and that actually after a cycle, so if you bring the system back to its original state, that quantity is conserved. So it's a state property of the system. But the other thing that he showed is that if you have a spontaneous change in the system, in an isolated system, that the entropy can never decrease. So the entropy of the universe tends to a maximum. And that's all very nice, but actually the problem with what Clausius gave to humanity by formulating the second law and introducing entropy is that he did not answer one question. And the one question that he did not answer is, what is entropy? And I mean, actually, I think that it was intentional that he did not do that, because he was very proud of his second law, and I think absolutely correctly, because that's one of the most basic laws of physics we have. And he was a bit worried that if he would give an interpretation of entropy, and that interpretation would turn out to be wrong, then somebody else could come up with the correct interpretation and at the same time claim the second law. So he just decoupled the two. He had his ideas, but he didn't write it when he wrote the article on the second law. So the first person to give us a microscopic interpretation of entropy was Ludwig Boltzmann. Here you see a picture of Boltzmann's grave, and on Boltzmann's grave you see this famous expression, S is K log W, and that basically is the expression that relates the entropy of the system to the logarithm of the number of states. And I mean, normally I devote much more time to this statement because it is totally mysterious at first, where you think, how can somebody in the 19th century formulate a law that assumes that the number of states of a system can be counted? And the short answer is actually that in this form, Boltzmann never wrote it. But the main thing is that the ideas of Boltzmann have been driving the subsequent theoretical interpretation of entropy. And so it's not just Boltzmann, but the person who really transformed it into what we now is statistical mechanics, was J. Willard Gibbs, who will come back to too, who was also one of my heroes. But anyway, Boltzmann was the first one to give a a physical interpretation of entropy in terms of the number of states of a system, and K, the Boltzmann constant. And this Boltzmann constant is there only because the dimensions of entropy had already been introduced before he introduced this law, so that you need a proportionality constant. So basically, the Boltzmann entropy is a measure for the number of states, and if you then go to Gibbs and you look at the classical mechanical interpretation of entropy where you don't count states, then you can say the entropy is related to the log of the volume of the phase space that is accessible to a system at constant energy. But I mean, that's just technical things. The main point is that if you try to discuss entropy, I wouldn't recommend it, but just in case you try to discuss entropy with people who are not trained in statistical mechanics, I would think that most people will say, well, we know what entropy is, because people have been taught that entropy is a measure for disorder. And I would say, and very often that is even true, but the subtle point about it is that entropy is a measure for disorder, but not necessarily the kind of disorder that we can see. And that's where the confusion comes from, and that has led to a lot of debates about which, one of which I will mention in a bit more detail, because computer simulation played a crucial role in understanding it. And that is the example of a situation where you go from a clearly visibly disordered state to an ordered state, namely if you look at freezing. So here you have a typical computer snapshot of a liquid, and here you have a computer snapshot of a crystal, and we assume for convenience that we have here a system that is at constant density and is isolated, and we all know that systems can freeze. So why is it that systems freeze? And the explanation that I was taught when I was a student is, well, of course, if you go from this state to that state, it becomes more ordered, so the entropy goes down. And so the only way you can actually make sure that this still happens spontaneously is that as particles get closer together, their potential energy decreases, so they can release heat to the rest of the universe, and that increases the entropy. So on the whole, the entropy still increases, although clearly that part of the system that is crystalline will have a lower entropy. So that's the way it was described, I would say, in most thermodynamics textbooks, and maybe it still is described like that. But there was a countercurrent, and the countercurrent actually started already in the 1940s with the work of two people, a well-known statistical mechanician, John Kirkwood, and a person who is much less known, Elizabeth Monroe. But I mean, although, again, normally I would say much more about Elizabeth Monroe, but let me just briefly say that she was a student at Bryn Mawr College, a student actually of Emmy Noether, who had fled from Germany to Bryn Mawr College. And she then did a PhD in Cambridge with Leonard Jones, and then went to the US and worked with Kirkwood on this problem, and then later on went into a completely different and probably even more important career that I will not discuss. A very, very interesting person. But they, in the 1940s, they say, well, actually crystallization can also happen without this energy release, so that you don't have to pay heat to the rest of the universe. There are ways in which you can actually make a system freeze spontaneously, simply because at a given density, it is possible that the entropy of the solid is higher than that of the liquid. And that is very counter to our idea that entropy is a measure for disorder, because you say, come on, the solid is ordered, the liquid is disordered, so how can this possibly be? But that is what they predicted in 1941. But it's not so easy to test this prediction, because you would have to look at a system that where the potential energy is constant. I mean, like, particles are not interacting, so that wherever they are, the potential energy is the same. And that basically means that you need hard particles that have no interaction beyond their direct repulsion at short distances. And of course, those systems didn't exist yet, although later we'll see that colloids have McBain would be very happy about that. Colloids have proved to be an excellent realization of systems, but that was decades later. So the first way to test the prediction of Monroe and Kirkwood was actually computer simulations. And in fact, the very earliest simulations, both Monte Carlo and molecular dynamics simulations, were precisely aimed at resolving this question: can hard particles freeze? And so I'll show you a picture of the people who did the first molecular dynamics simulations. And that is the famous duo Bernie Alder and Tom Wainwright. But let me very briefly say something about the third person on this picture, namely Marianne Mensah. Marianne Mensah was the person who, for Alder and Wainwright, did all the, she wrote the programs and she was running the program. So she was a crucial person in this whole activity. But I would say this was the 1950s and 60s. And so although she is acknowledged in the paper, she essentially was never a co-author. And I hope that that wouldn't happen again these days. I knew about Marianne Mensah because she was always acknowledged in the papers. I'd never met her until Bernie Alder's 90th birthday party, where she was at the dinner after the party. And so I was very happy to meet her and talk with her. And here you see a picture of Marianne Mensah together with Bernie Alder 55 years later. I should say that sadly Bernie Alder has died in September this year. I'm sorry. By now I've started to forget whether it was this year or last year, but he died just short of his 95th birthday. The main thing is that the calculations that then Alder and Wainwright published, but also in the same, basically the same location in the Journal of Chemical Physics, this is molecular dynamics. This was Monte Carlo simulation by Wood and Jacobson. This is Bill Wood. They both looked at the behavior, the phase behavior of hard spheres. And what you see here is the pressure. It's almost impossible to read. These are well-known hand-drawn graphs. And this is the volume. So as you decrease the volume of hard spheres, the pressure goes up. This is what they computed. And then suddenly it drops. And from here on, you have a different phase. So this is discontinuous phase transition. And this is a crystal. So at a fixed density, this system in simulation can go from here to there. And that means that in that case, the entropy of the crystal is higher than the entropy of the liquid. And that created a huge stir at the time. There were conferences where people discussed it, and there was even a round table discussion chaired by Uhlenbeck. And there were 16 people in the panel. Two had the Nobel Prize, and quite a few others should have had the Nobel Prize. And in the end, they couldn't resolve. And they voted whether it was possible that hard spheres would freeze. And eight were for and eight were against. And then in the end, Uhlenbeck said, yeah, and I also can't believe it. So they voted it down. But the nice thing about science is that it doesn't work by voting or even whether how important you are. In the end, it's all based on evidence. And I think that's an important lesson for today. So evidence in the end really completely validated what Alder and Wainwright and Wood and Jacobson had found. And it's a real phenomenon. And now I come briefly back to the colloids of McBain. It took until the 1980s when people could make colloidal suspensions of uncharged colloids in nonpolar solvents. Nonpolar solvents that could be stabilized and actually you have to do a bit more. You have to refractive index match the things, etc. And then these colloids behave like hard spheres. And this is an experiment, a famous experiment, done by Peter Pusey and Bill Vermeegen in 1986, where they had the suspension and they made it a different concentration. As you see, as you increase the concentration, you see these small specks forming in the sample. And these things are just crystals and they are colored because what you see is the Bragg reflection. This is not because the colors are typically have a diameter of a few hundred nanometers. The Bragg reflections are invisible and that's why you see colors. And so as you increase the density from here to there, then you see actually freezing of hard spheres, and it turned out that the concentrations, the volume fractions where this happened, were pretty much exactly as predicted by the simulation. So this was an experimental corroboration of the fact that you could have purely entropic freezing, which really has changed our view of what entropy can do. That yes, the entropy increases, but no, it's not necessarily a measure for the visible disorder. And to just give you one illustration again from something that in this case actually was seen in experiment before simulation, again by Peter Pusey, if you take a mixture of large and small hard spherical colloids with a certain size ratio, it is like I think 0.57, then the liquid will spontaneously freeze to form a hugely complicated crystal, so-called AB13 crystal, where icosahedra of the B particles are embedded in a simple cubic lattice of the A particles. And the reason why it happens is only because the entropy of this phase at the given density becomes higher than the entropy of that phase. And just to say one word about how can this possibly be? Well, if you jam a liquid to about a volume fraction of 63-64%, particles can't move. But you can compress a solid to 74% of the volume. And that means that if you have a solid at the density where these systems jam, the particles in the solid can still move, they can rattle. And that is precisely the kind of freedom that you need to make the solid the entropy higher than the liquid entropy. So that's very briefly this bit of entropy. But now I actually want to talk about what happened to entropy next. And there has been a lot of discussion of whether entropy can be exported to non-thermal systems, to systems that are not described by the laws of thermodynamics or conventional statistical mechanics. And of course, many entropy concepts have been introduced, but I think it is useful to first ask yourself, you can call anything you like, you can call it entropy, but when is it meaningful? And so I think that one thing is it should be a measure for probability. So basically saying that the entropy goes up as you go from one state to another in a spontaneous change in the end, and that's what we really learned from statistical mechanics, it means that the final state has a much higher probability in some sense than the original state. And so if you talk in terms of states, if you use Boltzmann, it just says that the final state has many more accessible states, and that's why it is likely to go from a situation with few states to a situation with many accessible states. So whatever entropy you introduce, I think it should be a measure for probability. But that's a bit more subtle, it also should be extensive. And the reason is that if you have two systems that are not interacting, are very weak interactions, that the probabilities of the two systems are just simply multiply, and the log of the probability is therefore additive. So the entropy should be additive, and so it has to be extensive, and I'll come back to that point later. And of course, it should increase during a spontaneous process in an isolated system. Now, a spontaneous process is easy to define if you have systems following the Newtonian laws of motion. In other cases, in sort of artificial systems that are not driven by a natural dynamics, you have to be very careful about what you mean by the spontaneous process. Okay, so now let me come back to the two kinds of entropy that I will briefly like to discuss. I will first say something about what I call data compression entropy, something that was introduced by Paul Chaikin and Dov Levine, but actually there was other people like Roy Beck-Barkai who did very similar work around the same time. But and then later I'll come back to Sam Edwards who worked on granular entropy. I know there are many other entropies, but I'll just pick those two examples. So the team at NYU, this is the New York University, did together with Stefano Martignani, who was my student and then moved to NYU at the time as a postdoc, is to look at a quantity of that is a measure for entropy in a sense, that is used computable information density. And it's basically the following thing. If you take a picture with your digital camera, with your phone, then the number of pixels is very, very large. But the way the information is stored is much more efficient. All these pictures make use of data compression algorithms that, for instance, if the picture is only white, then the amount of information to store it is very simple. Basically, what the image storage algorithm says is effectively one pixel white 5 million times. So that's a very short statement rather than repeating 5 million whites. So that is why if you have a very ordered image, you can use a short zip file, a short compressed file, whereas if you have a very disordered image, you'll have a longer zip file. So this is basically the idea that somehow you can imagine that the length of the compressed file is an indication of the degree of order, because if you have an order, you can easily sort of see the repeating units, and then you just say this unit repeated n times, rather than saying that you have to describe every individual unit. And so the definition that was explored by the NYU team is a definition, this quantity that is the length of the zipped file, the compressed file, divided by the length of the original file. And basically what they argue is that this quantity in the thermodynamic limit of sufficiently large data sets, also data sets where you sort of collect information about physical systems like a colloidal suspension, this quantity should approach something that's the entropy. I mean, strictly speaking, I think it is more related to the Shannon entropy, so the information entropy, but the hope was that it would actually also then allow you to say something about the physical entropy. And so I'll just give you one example that was studied by the NYU group, where they used this entropy concept for a non-equilibrium system where the normal entropy cannot be used. And the model is what they call the 2D random organization model, where you have the following rules: that you have, this is a two-dimensional system, the particles, you have particles that can here move about, but they only move if they're on top of each other. So if this particle is on top of the other particle, they both make a jump, and maybe this one jump on top of that one, and then they will jump again. So you can see how these particles jump, but at low density, at some point, they'll all jump to places where there's no other particle, and then they stand still. They can't move anymore. They have to be on top of each other in order to jump. And then the NYU group used this information entropy measure to look at I should say one more thing. At low densities, it is very easy to get a state where nothing moves. But at the high density, inevitably, whenever two particles overlap, one particle or another will jump on top of another particle. So there's a certain density beyond which it is impossible to reach what this quiescent state where nothing moves anymore. So you see here at low densities, this is the density. At low densities, everything is quiescent. This is the fraction of particles that are moving. Everything is quiescent. And then at a very well-defined density, you see that you can no longer have it stand still. So then the particles are diffusing, and that's this transition. And the interesting thing is that precisely at that point, the computed entropy, and this is random organization entropy, undergoes also what looks like a transition. So it initially goes with following this curve, which is like the curve for a hard disk like fluid, and then suddenly you see it goes onto this other fluid where it goes through the situation of effectively random systems. So you can clearly detect this transition using this entropy just simply by looking at snapshots of the system. Now we were interested in knowing, and this is the project we did together with Srikant Sastry in Bangalore, we wanted to know to what extent you can use these ideas to apply them to real three-dimensional systems. They had been tested on, I would say, the Ising model, but the Ising model it looks so much like a bit string that it is maybe not the best example. So we thought, let's first test it on a very simple system, and that's the ideal gas. And there, actually, it looked quite encouraging. We could define what I think is a fairly unique definition of the information entropy. And here you see the entropy, the red circles are what you compute using this information density, and the black curve is simply the ideal gas law for the entropy. I mean, apart from constants that are unimportant. And so you see, in this case, it works extremely well. We knew without any adjustable parameters, we knew what the entropy had to be, except for, I mean, there's a constant offset that you can never know in classical entropy. Then we thought, okay, this is extremely encouraging. Now we know how to calibrate this entropy, so let's now apply it to interacting systems. And I must say that it didn't work. So I did it for the Lennard-Jones fluid, which is like a model for argon or for simple noble gases. And if you look, you see that the entropy as computed, so it's the excess entropy compared to the ideal gas, the entropy computed from the equation of state is this curve as a function of density. And here you get what we get from this information density. So they look very, very different. And certainly, so we thought this doesn't look like it really measures the quantity that we call entropy. Now, the thing is that you can, of course, rescale these results. And it turns out that if you rescale, it looks like the shape of the curve is okay. But of course, rescaling is arbitrary, so that we don't like a theory where you have to rescale your results every time to get agreement with the experiment. Because in the end, in simulations, I would say disagreement is much more interesting than agreement. So yes, you can rescale it, but it doesn't tell me anything. Third point, is the entropy changing during a spontaneous a process in the system? And I must say that this is a bit of a complicated figure, because this is a situation where, again, for this information, this random organization model, where depending on the situation you choose, you can have situations where the entropy goes either up or it goes down. Now I must be a bit careful, because there are different ways of looking at the same problem, and maybe I'm oversimplifying a bit. But it certainly is, as far as you can tell, correct, that there is not an immediate relation between what happens spontaneously and the increase of entropy, although I think that problem possibly can be fixed. But the real killer for this information density approach, I think, is that it has truly awful finite size effects. And here I really must rely on what is known from the people who have been studying data compression, and because they know that there's a finite size effect, and that you only reach the, what I mentioned, that if in the end the length of the compressed file divided by the length of the original file should approach the Shannon entropy, but it approaches it very, very, very slowly. And how slowly? It goes as the log of n, the number of particles, divided by log n. Now, this is an absolute killer, because all our simulations were in this regime, and you effectively never can get to the regime where this thing should go to zero, because that requires astronomically large numbers of particles. So this was impossible. And here in this plot, this is where the entropy should end up. We know this from the simulations. And you can say, oh, well, it's compatible with what we see here, but surely you cannot extrapolate from here to there. So at the moment, I'm not very optimistic that this approach will actually allow us, simply by looking at a snapshot of a system, to estimate this entropy. Now let's have a look at, at granular entropy. And this is where Sam Edwards enters into the game. So in the late 1980s, Sam Edwards in Cambridge was working on the problem of what he called powders, and what people have since called granular materials. And of course, powders, the particles are sufficiently large that they are not subject to Brownian motion. I mean, there is Brownian motion, but it's unobservably small. And so, but at the same time, the powders contain many, many particles. And so the hope was that you could still use the ideas of statistical mechanics, but translate it in a different way to actually say something about the behavior of powders. And so then you have to look at what is the the quantity that I mean, first of all, you cannot in thermodynamics, the entropy is a function of the energy of the system, the volume of the system, and the number of particles. And in powders, the energy plays no role, because in the end, all the particles, when they come to rest, they don't move. Their interaction is negligible, and so that's not important. So the important thing is the volume, and so it means that you can possibly construct the thermodynamics if you have an entropy that is a function of the volume. And so what Sam Apter said, there is a quantity that looks like the temperature, which in thermodynamics, temperature is the variation of the energy with the entropy. And he said, we have something similar for powders, and it's the variation of the volume with the entropy, but this is a different entropy. This is the granular entropy. And this quantity actually called compactness and later compactivity, but anyway, it is a quantity that looks like temperature. But the important thing is, what's this granular entropy? And so Sam Atwood said, well, this is a well-defined quantity. It is the logarithm of the number of weights in which the grains can be assembled to fill the volume. So that's a very interesting concept, because it's different. I mean, we don't talk about the volume of phase space. We talk about how many distinct ways are there to pack particles in a container. And I'll come back to that in a minute. But I should say that this statement that you take the entropy is the log of the number of ways that which grains can be used to fill the volume makes an assumption, and that is very similar to the assumption in statistical mechanics, where you basically have the underlying assumption that all states of a system with the same energy are equally likely. And here you have implicit for granular entropy the similar, what we call ergodic hypotheses, all packings are equally likely. Now that there is no a priori reason to believe that, and I'll come back to that in general, but so that is the first thing we want to know. The second thing we want to know is there a second law? And that's much less easy to define, because in the second law, you need to define what a spontaneous process is. And in these granular materials, they only move when you shake them. So basically, you can always talk about spontaneous changes during a particular protocol to prepare the sample, like tapping or shaking, but you have to specify what you do. And then, of course, the crucial thing that was absolutely essential to make any progress at all is, can we compute this granular entropy, the log of the number of ways in which you can pack particles? And at first sight, the answer seems to be no. And to explain that, let's look at a very simple experiment that I did at home. Here I have a vase, and I put in spheres, all a bit different, so they don't have the same size. And if you throw the spheres in a vase, you get a distinct packing. And the kind of problems that we all know that are certainly relatively easy to solve if you have good tomography or other imaging is, you can count the spheres. So if you have this vase and you take a tomography image, you just can count the spheres. That's easy. The hard problem, the Edwards problem, is how many packings are there? So I have this packing, I take it out, or I take a snapshot, I take it out, throw the spheres in again, I get a different packing. How many distinct packings are there? And the number of packings, first of all, I'd say it's a discrete number, so in principle it's finite, but in practice it's not countable, and later I'll show how not countable it is. And so this is something where computer simulations can help if you're willing to go to other algorithms. And that's the thing that I find always very interesting, how in computer simulations, algorithms that have been developed in one context can be applied to something else. So I slightly generalized the problem from taking the packing of hard particles to looking at the system with slightly soft particles. And the reason is that if you make the system slightly soft, but still with the same finite range of interaction, then the minima of the potential energy corresponds to mechanically stable packings. But the advantage is that now you have defined the potential energy surface everywhere else in between. This is not a real picture of a granular packing. This is just a picture I stole from my colleague David Wales, who does energy landscapes. So this is an energy landscape. You see all these packings. these particular minima. And so what you would like to know is to know how many minima are there. That's basically the equivalent question that we can ask. And the idea basically that we employed is the following. Suppose that you have a system and it has a potential energy. This is a very simple 1D example, but suppose the potential energy has a number of minima. Then the first thing you can say is that if I take the system initially at any point and I minimize the energy, here I would end up here. If I did this, I end up here. If I would start here, I would end up there. So depending on where you start, you end up in different minima, and every minimum has its own basin of attraction. So this minimum has this basin of attraction, this minimum has this basin of attraction. So the important thing to note is that together, all these basins of attraction, they tile the entire space. So every initial condition corresponds to a minimum. And so that is something that now I sketched in 1D, but then we try to extend to a higher dimensional case where we basically say, we have a system and we know that it has a very large number of minima, and we also know that if you look at the minima with their surrounding basin of attraction, that together they fill the total space. And the total space is something very similar, simple, because that is just the volume of the system in phase space. So that for an ideal gas, that would be the volume to the power n. So that's easy. And we know that it's filled with all these basins. And that turns out to be important. But what people did initially when they looked at the number of packings of spheres is they just enumerate. So they created a packing numerically, and then they took a snapshot. I mean, they saved the configuration, and then they made another packing and another and another. And they just tried to see when the same packing started to recur, because then you know that you start to saturate the total number of packings. And that's basically how it was done. But that is very time consuming, and more importantly, it's memory consuming. Because every time you have a packing, you have to store the configuration to compare it with everything that follows. So to see, have I seen this already? So that's why it is rather difficult to do this efficiently. And so so this had been tried at the time that we did our work to, I think, 15 or 16 particles, and then it really was burning too much computer time. And so the alternative that we followed is this, what I would call the average volume route. And I mean, normally I spend more time explaining it, but I'll say it just in a few words. I already mentioned that if you start from any initial configuration of a system, now you talk about n particles. So say any configuration means any point that an ideal gas could occupy. So you take particles random in the volume, and then you switch on the interaction and you minimize the energy. And then you'll find that there is a certain, for every energy minimum, there is a certain basin of attraction that has a certain volume. But we know that all together, all these volumes fill the whole volume of the phase space, which is an easy quantity computer, like V to the power n. And then we have the very simple relation that the average volume of the basin times the number of volumes is the volume of the phase. So this is simple. This is what we want to know. And this average volume is something you don't have to do by enumeration. This you can do by sampling. So now, like in the Monte Carlo method of the 1950s, we have translated an enumeration problem into a sampling problem. And that of course makes a huge difference for the computing time. And so rather than go into the technical details, I'll just show you what it shows. So this is an example of a two-dimensional polydispersed hard disk system. I told you that the old simulations had to stop somewhere here, the brute force enumeration. We can go in this case up to 128 particles. Since then, we have done simulations up to 1500 or 2000 particles. Sadly, that has still not been published because the student who did it then went on to do a PhD in machine learning and was so busy that he couldn't actually write down the things he'd done. But I'm sure that that's going to come. We have been able to do it to much, much larger systems. And the interesting thing is that if you look now at the log of the number of packings, that's a large number. And so actually, for the 128 particles, the number of packings is 10 to the power 250. And this is what I mean when I said you can't possibly do brute force enumeration. This number is just too large. It also shows something interesting, and that is that in computer simulations over the past decades, there has been a huge gain due to increase in computing power. But I think that in many cases, no, not in many cases, in a number of cases, there has been an even larger gain due to the use of algorithms. So in this case, at the time that we published this, this was 10 to the power 240 best, better than the best brute force method. So there was really a huge, huge gain to be obtained by going to a different algorithm. Now, I should also say that here I just count the number of basins, but it's not obvious that the basins all have the same volume. And in general, when we looked at the initial systems that we studied, we found that different basins had different volumes. And it doesn't mean that we can't use entropy anymore, but we have to use not the Boltzmann entropy, but we use the Gibbs entropy. And actually, the Gibbs entropy is in terms of related to probability of ending up in a certain basin. For the in the Boltzmann case, these probabilities would be all the same, 1 over omega. In the Gibbs entropy, they're all different. But this is something that actually is very nice because for our computationally, because we can compute this quite easily, or easily, I mean, still, it is very expensive, but not exponentially expensive. And importantly, if you go to the case where everything is equally likely, the Boltzmann case, then this probability is 1 over omega, and you see that then the Gibbs entropy is simply equal to the Boltzmann entropy. Okay. Now, the first question that I said is, all right, one of the properties that I mentioned about entropy is that it has to be a measure of probability, and it has to be extensive. That means that if you double the system size, the entropy should double. I don't care what the slope is, but I just want to make sure that the entropy as a function of system size is a straight line that goes through the origin as a function of the number of particles. And this is what we saw in our simulations. And until now, I didn't focus too much on what happens at small system sizes, but actually this thing does not go through the origin. I mean, and then you say, oh, well, it may be a small effect, but in everything we looked at, it didn't go through the origin. And sorry. And that actually is a real problem. I mean, this behavior is not what you want of a decent entropy. And so for reasons that I'll come back to later, I suggested that actually what we should look at is not the number of packings, but we should divide the number of packings by n factorial, the number of particles. And that if you do that, and of course that sounds extremely strange, because all these particles are different. They're polydispersed particles. We divide the omega, the number of packings, by n factorial, and and then I'll see that he'll show you that it changes the picture. And I'll come back to why it is not a nonsensical thing to do to divide by n factorial. But first, let's look at the results. So now we take this granular entropy, the number of packings of particles are all slightly different. We divide the number of packings by n factorial and then take the log. And I must say these 2D results are the old ones that are still noisy. The 3D results were more recent. And you see that actually this now is completely compatible with a straight line through the origin. So this entropy, the log of the number of packings divided by n factorial, really behaves like an extensive entropy, which we thought was extremely nice. I should apologize for one thing, and as you see, there are no error bars on these points, and that is basically because in these simulations we really were extremely limited in the number of configurations that we could take. So although that doesn't mean that we couldn't have error bars, the student involved was a bit embarrassed to put in all the error bars, but basically I can assure you that all these points are within the error bar from the straight line, so that actually in that sense it's okay, but we should have added error bars. Now, the other thing that I said is this ergodic hypothesis that if you use the Edwards expression, then you would assume that all the basins are equally likely to be occupied. But we find that actually if you have a system of particles that are compressed so that they all overlap a bit, then the basins are not equally populated. And so we were interested to see what would happen if you then expand the system to the point where the particles just touch, because that is the situation that you typically reach when you pour spheres in a container. Then they just touch, but they're not compressed like caviar in a box or a small sort of like deformable spheres. So what happens just at the moment when they start touching? And that is what you see in the following picture. It's a slightly strange picture. This is again the volume fraction. This red line is the point where the jamming transition takes place. This has been studied by other people like Sid Nagel, Andrea Liu, but I mean also many other groups. And what we look at here is the Gibbs entropy, and which is the blue curve, the minus p log p, and this is the log omega. And I said if the ergodic hypothesis that all the basins are equally populated is true, then the Gibbs entropy should be the same as the Boltzmann entropy. And you see that as you decrease the distances to jamming, then you seem to go to the same point. Now, why don't we have points here? That's precisely because here the calculations become incredibly expensive. So I would say this extrapolation is of course a bit of wishful thinking, or a lot of wishful thinking. I hope that with increased computing power and maybe better algorithms, we can get close to this to verify that this is really true. Although I should say that Stefano, together with Bulbul Chakrabarty at Brandeis and our collaborators, did a very careful finite size scaling analysis where they really concluded that at this jamming point, all the packings are equally likely, which still is an extremely surprising observation. And I must admit, I don't understand it at all. And that, to me, just illustrates that Sam Edwards was a genius, and I think very few people would contest that. I have to come back to one thing, and that's the n factorial, and that's the last thing I will tell. I said we have polydispersed particles, all particles are different, and then I divide the number of packings by n factorial, which is something that you say you can't do that. That is reserved for something else. And so where does the n factorial come from? It is something that was introduced by in a slightly different way by Gibbs. No, not in a different way. It was introduced by Gibbs, certainly in his book on statistical mechanics of 1902, where he divides partition functions of identical particles by n factorial. And later, people have been looking at the Gibbs paradox, and it would like, why is the entropy going up if you mix different gases, but it's not going up if you mix two amounts of the same gas? And they all say, well, it has to do with the quantum mechanical indistinguishability of particles. And so these are just quotes from different textbooks from the 20th century on statistical mechanics. And I will not go through all the texts, except that they all say that you need quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics. So they all say this you can't understand classically, except of course there are some exceptions. I will also one is Landau and Lifshitz. Landau and Lifshitz is one of those wonderful books that if you read the book before you understand the subject, then you don't see what they write, and after you find that, oh, they said it already. Here it's a footnote, and Landau and Lifshitz say, from a purely classical viewpoint, the need for the interpretation of this n factorial arises because otherwise the statistical weights would no longer be multiplicative. So that's basically this extensivity argument that I mentioned before. So they knew very well. I will also go back to what Gibbs said originally in his when he introduced the Gibbs paradox, and it is an extremely confusing sentence. This is something that had been noted by James, who has written an article about the Gibbs paradox, because this is how Gibbs explains the Gibbs paradox for the mixing of two gases. He says, when such gases have been mixed, there is no more impossibility of the separation of the two kinds of molecules in virtue of their ordinary motion in the gaseous mass without any special external influence than there is of the separation of a homogeneous gas into the same two parts into which it has once been divided after these have once been mixed. And James comments quite correctly that this is totally incomprehensible. So you don't know really what Gibbs wants to say, at least I don't. So I thought, rather than trying to understand the sentence, I do an experiment, and I think that almost certainly this experiment will not work if I use the laser pointer. So I quickly have to. Oh wait, what is the pointer option? What is the? I guess it's the one. Like this maybe. Yeah. So I did an experiment where I took a suspension of colloidal particles, in this case it's milk, and then I just first I had them in one container. The particles are all similar but very but not identical, and then I removed a dividing surface the way Gibbs indicated. So there we go. And I checked carefully if there's anything that happened to the entropy. I couldn't see anything. And then, of course, the next step is to do the reverse experiment. I just follow Gibbs to the letter. So I separated them again. And then again, I checked the entropy. And I conclude that, again, nothing has happened. Which is basically the old Gibbs paradox. Gibbs, of course, said it about gases of equal and unequal particles. But here, you basically what you see is, and of course, I'm cheating, but what you see is that if you have a system that where the macro states of the two halves of the system are indistinguishable, then it is pointless to say that the entropy is increasing. And so I take a very simple argument, and that's the last thing I'll tell, I say, let's consider an ideal gas of particles that are all different but have the same properties. So you could say a colloidal gas, then the partition function classically would be just v to the power n plus factors I don't care about. If you take two such systems, it is v1 to the power n plus times v2, so that g to two volumes, v1 to the n1, v2 to the n2, and then you have a factor that tells you how many ways you can distribute the particles over these two volumes. Now, the thing is that these particles are all identical, except that they are distinguishable. And now the thing is that if you then look at what happens if I add a particle, move a particle from one system to the other, and you want to look at the situation where the log of this thing is maximum, then what comes out is immediately that, well, I mean, where does the number of particle enter? It's here, it's there. This we keep fixed, so it's here and there. So the thing that has to be has to basically give you a zero derivative is the log of this thing over n one factorial plus the log of that thing over n two factorial, and that's how you in the end.
I'm sorry to interrupt. We have lost your cursor or the laser pointer.
Okay. So I'm actually, this is my last slide. So basically what I want to say is that if you use that, then you get that it's the number of realizations over n factorial just rather than this one. And with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention.
Okay. So thank you, Dan, for this wonderful talk. And we will now open the floor to questions.
I just have to see how I can stop sharing. That's the other thing.
No, don't stop sharing. You might have to go back to your slides.
There we have yes. Dov.
Yes. So I will. I don't know. The chat facility seems to be not working. So we will unmute everyone who has raised their hand to ask questions. Mr. Mani, can you help me unmute others? Some of my yes, I can do it myself. Okay, let me try. The first question, Dr. Dow, you can ask the question, and I can see Prasad also there. You can unmute yourself, I guess, right? We have given permission to everyone.
Hi, Dan. How are you? Great to see you. I want to let me just bring you up to date on a few of the things that you mentioned. The first thing is, after a very, very, very long odyssey, we are able now to accurately, in the sense of no scaling, no scale factors, yeah, and things like that, handle systems which are discrete. So we can do soft spheres, hard spheres, we can handle XY models in whatever dimension you'd like. Mm-hmm. It was very hard.
Yeah.
In fact, it's extremely subtle, and it would be great to talk to you about it. But I do think that it's important, yeah, to point out that we have fewer of these of the malaises that you're, right, talking about. The other thing is,
I mean, by the way, I heard Paul Chaykin refer to this, so I know that something was brewing, but I couldn't yet discuss it. But I of course love to know more about it.
Yeah, it took us well over a year to get it to the point which we, I think, just got it to where we can actually send for publication, which is why we haven't sent it out. I mean, we really wanted the dot I's, cross T's, and have objective, sure, criteria, and it was by no means easy. So your the points you made are correct, but I think it's more correct to the old data compression routines, yeah, and less to what's possible now. Perfect. The other point I think should be made, I mean, the rising or falling of entropy in the system you showed, which was for active Brownian particles, I don't think is particularly problematic. It's out of equilibrium. If you start the system in a more or less ordered state than it's going to end up in, it'll go either way.
I don't think that's too
serious. And the final point is, as with respect to the slow convergence, I would call it slow convergence rather than extensivity. Indeed, things do converge very slowly. However, if you're lucky, and sometimes we are, you can bound the convergence both above and below by the same function, and therefore you can sensibly get the asymptotic value. Otherwise, you really would be in deep trouble. So anyway, those comments. That's all.
Thank you. that's wonderful. So basically, I think that's a nice thing. This whole field is still in motion, and things are happening and evolving. So that's great. Okay.
Thank you. And the next question by BLV Prasad. We can't hear you. Prasad, you need to unmute yourself.
Okay, yeah. Wonderful lecture, Dan. I hope you remember your visit to MCL previous time.
Yes.
There was a in the ES workshop. You gave a fantastic lecture, a tutorial lecture to the students. So my question is mostly about this colloidal particle self-assembling, where, like, you know, generally we have systems that are basically having inorganic particles which are hard core kind, and then there is a ligand shell which kind of has some kind of a repulsive interactions also included. So for those kinds of systems, we also see that if the ligand shell is longer, and sometimes they don't try to self-assemble or So how do you explain those things with this entropy?
I think that if you have particles with different kinds of interactions, it really depends on how you define entropy. If you wish to define entropy simply in terms of the log of the number of mechanically stable minima, then I think you could still use the idea. The question is really whether it's a particularly useful concept. So in particular, if you look, for instance, at systems close to the jamming transition, the community of people who are working on this problem, they say, well, the closer you get to jamming, the more minima you get, and the shallower they are. And at some point, I think Patrick Charbonneau even says that it becomes infinite, which I doubt for a finite system, but they become very large. And so the question is whether that's a meaningful quantity to look at if you're interested in entropy. So it's not so much that you can't compute it, but I very much doubt it's a particularly meaningful thing to look at.
I'm looking for hands raised, and or if anyone can whoever wants to ask questions can unmute themselves and introduce them and ask the question. This is to the audience. I hope they're able to unmute if they want to.
Sarika, can I ask a question?
Yes, so who is this? I can't.
This is Rajarshi, actually.
Yes, Rajarshi, please go ahead.
Yeah, so I'm just thinking, so if you have a situation like you have a bunch of active particles, what Chaikin did this experiment.
Yes.
And they come, they're hard sphere, but they have this persistent motion. And you switch on the light and they come and they form clusters. So will your argument hold there? This entropy increases during this process. Similar argument will hold, or you have to have some...
I mean, I didn't talk about active particle, but it's certainly a very relevant point, because this is a situation where you have an underlying dynamics, and so you can define precisely what you mean by a spontaneous process. And then, of course, if you were to look at just the existing definition of entropy, then almost certainly you would conclude that the entropy is going down. From a thermodynamics point of view, that's fine. You're consuming energy, so there's no problem. On the other hand, if you look at it more from the information perspective, then you say this is a spontaneous process. So whatever quantity you use to characterize the probability, that should go up. I don't know whether that satisfies you as an answer, but I think that this is a situation where you can clearly see how the thermodynamic picture at some point is not adequate to describe systems out of equilibrium. I mean, maybe Dov wants to add something to that too. I mean, that's a
right. Thank
anyway,
you.
So that's my yes. my.
Can discuss comment. Later. Yeah. Thank you.
I can see more hands. I'm not sure if I'm following the order, but I can see. You can go ahead. Soumya Ranjan, can you unmute yourself and ask a question? Hello. So whoever, my mic is not working. Okay. So can you type the question, sir, or we will move on to the next?
There are typed questions also.
You can see them. I don't.
Yes, I can.
Any comments on entropy versus original life theory? Okay,
the short answer is no, but I think that apart from the fact that there is, to my knowledge, no contradiction whatsoever between the second law of thermodynamics and the origin of life, I don't have anything more specific to say about that. Maybe that's too short.
There is another, I can see hand raised by Sungkan Go. I don't know if I'm pronouncing the name properly, but you can go ahead and ask.
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, it is correctly pronounced. Okay. I was a bit puzzled by your answer to Rajesh's question, in a sense that, if the system is undergoing some spontaneous process, entropy is expected to increase. That is the answer. Yeah. But if we consider passive system, just passive 3D Lennard-Jones system that are distributed in certain way, coupled to some thermal reservoir, and if it is undergoing spontaneous process by the energy exchange with the reservoir, because it is not isolated system, it will undergo phase separation, entropy will decrease if you are only focused within the system, I think. So, isn't it somewhat contradictory?
No, I think that's fine, because if you have a system in contact with a reservoir, then the second law of thermodynamics would apply to the system plus reservoir. That's the isolated system, and there the entropy always increases. So the fact that in part of the system the entropy decreases, and in other parts of the system the entropy increases, but more, that is fine. There's no problem at all.
So if you have a look at the active system, which for which and there's a influx of energy, not isolated, so entropy decreasing within the system, I think it is okay.
Sure, sure. I mean, I agree that if you look at just the entropy balance, there's no problem at all. I mean, so active matter in that sense completely obeys the second law of thermodynamics. The question that I think would be another question to ask is, if you look at the system of active particles, is there another entropy-like quantity or free energy-like quantity that has to be an extremum as you approach the well, not the equilibrium state, but the final steady state? And that might be a different quantity. And sometimes, in some cases, we may know it. I mean, if you talk in terms of effective interactions, some cases we don't know it.
Okay, in that case, I don't think there will be Shannon entropy, I guess.
No, okay, sorry. Yeah, that may well be true. Maybe that was too flippant.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
So I guess in active matter, you have both information entropy and chemical entropy, and certain systems can have both, and certain systems might not have the chemical entropy, but can have the information entropy, right? My kid gave a talk last week, and he mentioned about sheep and goat separation and how that can have information entropy, but not the chemical entropy that we talk about.
Yeah.
So there is Shankar.
But I mean, there too, it's very much based on the situation that is, if you look at a particular process and the reverse process, that the relative probability of those two allow you to define an entropy that effectively is related to probability.
Yes.
Sorry. Yes, I interrupted you.
No. The next question is by Shankar. Shankar, can you unmute yourself?
So when you count configurations, you are doing some kind of a discretization to the problem. How do you set the discretization parameter? After all, these are like real space numbers, and you are truncating at some point and then doing a counting.
I mean, are you talking about the granular problem or
either way around? For example, when you are doing the 3D image compression, as well as as well as for your counting of your granular system, say that, you know, I have got this configuration and I'm differentiating it from the other configuration, there's some way you have discretized the problem. How did you?
Okay, I mean, so in the second case, if you're counting energy minima, actually the discretization is natural because there is a countable number of minima. So that is not an issue. In the case of the image compression or the equivalent thing, the information contained in the coordinates of a particle, an off-lattice model of particles, the way we did it is to say, well, you describe the particles by a real number, but of course, in a computer, a real number has always a finite number of bits. And so, yes, in that sense, it is discretized, because in any numerical simulation, in the deep down, you work with discrete numbers. And then we just look at the degree of, I mean, basically the data compression for every bit individual, for the last bit, the last but one, etc. And the lower the last bits effectively contain noise. They contain no information. If you move a particle by a picometer, nothing changes in the system. So the information tends to be in the leading bits, and that's why you, although in principle yes, you discretize, you can also argue that whatever you ignore is the bits that would go from, I mean, bit number 32 up to infinity, that actually contains no information at all. So I don't think it's a serious discretization.
And for the granular part, you said that that's not a problem?
No, in the granular part, the particles, I mean, you just count the number of potential energy minima, and that is a discrete number to begin with.
Are there any other hands raised? I can I can't see. I can see some hands here, but I'm unable to figure out who that is. Can you unmute yourself and ask the question? Because I can't see all the attendees.
No more, Sarika. Only Shankar's hand is still raised, but I don't see.
Okay. So can I ask one?
If there are no more questions, I'll ask for a clarification because I completely missed this part. Where you had this plot where you had log of log n by log n, where did that come from? I just missed that complaint.
I said that is not at all from my own background. That is the people who have been looking at data compression, who have been studying have argued for this rule. And I think that Dov Levine just argued that actually there's not just there's limiting behaviors, upper and lower limits, that allows you to bracket what the real answer should be. But first, the early results, I know it's there, but I'm not familiar with that literature. And the recent results that Dov referred to, I haven't seen yet.
Thanks.
Then I wanted to ask a question. And so what I understood from your last part, and this I heard before, but let me just clarify it. So you're saying that n factorial is not the distinguishability factor that is giving rise to it, right? That's what you're trying to say.
Because, I mean, that's not original. Sorry. Yeah, okay. Yes. Yes. I'm not the first one to say that. I'm the last one to say that, sir.
Yes. Okay. So there has been a lot of studies on how you define the numbers like this. How do you calculate the entropy of this political system? And then factorial part has been used there to say that, okay, it is infinite degrees of, like, you know, the entropy diverges in thermodynamic limits. So you would say no, that is not the case, right? Your argument would say we will always have to have an n factorial sitting there in the ideal gas calculation.
So polydispersed systems, certainly continuously polydispersed systems, are subtle, because if you look at the entropy, then you can say, well, if you take the operational point of view, that you consider those states of the system as indistinguishable, where basically macroscopically you can't separate it. Basically, it is also the argument that James used. If you can't separate two components, then to all intents and purposes they are indistinguishable from an observational point of view. Now, for polydispersed systems, we know that you may have, for instance, a distribution of particle sizes, and by a certain fractionation procedure, you may separate them. We can say, for instance, we can separate it in effectively two or three or four components, but maybe later experiments will enable you to separate many more. And that would change the number of the entropy, not the system size dependent, but the number of the entropy. If in the end you can define, you can separate every single particle, then the entropy itself diverges, but then it also becomes meaningless, because if every particle is different, then the very idea of equilibrium under exchange of particles goes away. If you swap two particles that have identical properties but are not distinguishable, you get the same final state. If you swap two particles that are different, then this is not the same as that. I mean, I usually use the example of people who collect stamps. So if I see two people exchanging two stamps, and I think, well, it's the same final state. I mean, they both have a stamp. But of course, to the people who collect stamps, it makes a huge difference whether this is a Mauritian 8052 or the one from the Cape from 1871. I mean, so to them it's distinguishable. To me, it's not. And so it has to do with techniques. And as soon as everything is distinguishable, then actually the thermodynamics of systems where you exchange particles become meaningless.
Okay, but I thought your experiment or your simulations were on polydispersed systems, right? Where you without the n factorial, you couldn't match the result, right?
Yes, absolutely, absolutely. Yeah.
But it was not continuous polydispersity.
The thing is, it is continuous polydispersity, but the thing is that if you can still do a kind of binning of particles into certain sizes, and the bin width does affect the total value of the entropy, but it doesn't change the n factorial like dependence.
Yes, of course, but it does change the number of species and the total value of entropy.
Absolutely, absolutely. So I mean, in that sense, the actual number itself depends on how you decide to do it.
Thank you, Dan. And we just hope that we will meet in person soon when things open up and we are in the different world again. Let me just end this meet today by going for a formal thank you note. So as part of NCL named lecture committee, me and my colleagues would like to sincerely thank Professor Dan Frenkel for delivering the McBain Memorial Lecture. Thanks to our director, Dr. Ashish Lele, for his continued support. I would also like to thank Mr. Sunil Patel, who is the event coordinator, Dr. Nikhilesh Yadav, Ms. Sonali, Mr. Balaji, Sri Ganesh Mani, Mr. Hare Krishna Kunjal, Mr. Devtale, Mr. Askar, Mr. Saini, and Mr. Ronaki. They have been there in the management team with whom we don't get to see, you know, to make sure that, you know, the videos are operating properly, people yes. can join and other things. And last but not the least, I would like to thank you all for your presence today to make it a successful seminar. Thank you, Dan.
And thank you and all the organizers and the technical support team for everything they've done. Thank you very much indeed. Okay.